We do apologize for the technical difficulties this morning. I'm pretty sure it's got something to do with the thunder, lightning, and a little bit of rain we had last night. Hopefully, they'll all be sorted. Or there's an alien playing with our satellite. One of the two. I'm going to go, it's more likely to do with the rain, but you never know what's out there in space. Like, you never know what's around the corner here on Luma. Okay, so we're making a big loop back towards where those buffalo came from, trying to see if there's any sign of the lions behind them. Now, it looks like the hippo has had a good evening wandering all about, and only hippo tracks, the only really fresh tracks I've seen apart from the wild dog tracks that went back to the west are hippo tracks. So probably from 4:30 this morning on their way back to their respective water holes. Now we are hoping to find some lovely lion tracks on top of the rain. But it is going to be quite a pretty morning as the sun fights its way through the cloud. Still lots of moisture in the air. And I'm hoping we're going to find the incredible Nkahumas shortly. But remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to ask us any questions. And again, do bear with us as we fight our way through our tech problems. Now, while we are driving through the greenery, hoping to spot a tawny cat, let's go to James, who's got an antelope.
More accurately, we have the back end of an antelope, and that is a nyala. That was a nyala. That was the best sighting ever, wasn't it, David? It was just fantastic. Let's just move a little forward. I was hoping that it wouldn't move off and that we might be able to get a shot of it with the drone so that you could see the perspective. But it's now moving off, so let's go and get a better look. We're on a road called Mamba Road, where mercifully I have yet to see a mamba. But I did have my first meeting with the Queen on this road, and I will show you the tree that it happened in, David. It is the marula tree off to the right-hand side there. It was in that tree, everybody, that the Queen and I met, and I made the dreadful mistake of calling her slightly pug-faced. Well, Twitter exploded that day. I haven't made that mistake again. Let's just go a little bit further forward. There's the nyala, very cleverly hidden in amongst the strychnos trees. Two nyala. Could there possibly be a third? Three nyala? Bulls, all? One there, two off to the side here, in amongst the Strychnos madagascarensis. Moving forward again. Now the light is going to be very gorgeous as it breaks through the clouds here. There we go. Beautiful shot. There we go. So some young bulls and one big bull trying desperately to graze, obviously right behind the tree where I've parked David. There we go. Just beautiful. Now, the sun is starting to poke through the clouds, like I said, which means that the water is starting to evaporate off the ground, the plants are starting to transpire, and that means that it's starting to get very close, very muggy indeed. It feels very tropical this morning. How that cannot be considered the most magnificent antelope we get out here, I just don't know. Aren't they spectacular? I just do apologize once again, everybody, for all the technical glitches we've had this morning. I think you'll find that it has quite a lot to do with the atmospheric conditions. Charged water particles or water vapor particles all over the place and various other charged particles. Ah, Brent Leo Smith has managed to find a leopard tortoise. Let's go and see.
Here we go. It's a massive leopard tortoise, probably over 50 years old. And here he marches off. And you can see those incredible feet of theirs. Isn't that amazing? So it's a male. We could just see that slightly concave belly. Look at that. So with the rain, lots of little bits of groundwater around and lots of grazing around. So it's a good time to be a tortoise. Now, there's very few animals that are going to be able to crack open a tortoise of this age. He's got that massive armored shell around him, but hyenas could possibly, also ground hornbill might possibly be able to break open that carapace. But at, once they're this age, that carapace is so thick and well developed, it's gonna be very, very difficult for any creature to get in there. It's gonna be interesting to see what he does now as he comes up towards that branch. I don't think he's gonna be able to go under. We might just stop there for a graze. Now, I've just heard that the lion tracks have been discovered on the Buffalo cut line, a little bit further to the east from where we were checking. So we're gonna head off towards that area to give Johanna a hand. Fingers crossed. Now, it sounds like those buffalo could have easily been highly mobile because of the lions. So we're gonna think we'll do Gallagher shortcut and have a look there. Now, Taylor is out and about on foot, so let's go say good morning to her. Oh, it seems like you're still with us. So, welcome back, or you never left. So, as you can see, I've increased my speed slightly to try get towards that area where the lion tracks are. It is, the tracks are on the northern boundary, so we don't want to dally about, and just in case they do decide to pop through to the north. And again, we do apologize for all the tech issues this morning. Hopefully they will be over soon. Okay, it seems like Taylor has put on her makeup and blow dried her hair and she is now ready. So let's say good morning.
I've gone with the all natural look today, and today I'm going to look like a marula tree. Good morning everybody and welcome to our wonderful safari, or sunrise safari. I missed it this morning though. Of course, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me we've got Brian, and Herbert is out keeping us safe. Now, it's really nice today. It's actually quite a pleasant day to be walking. It's not too hot just yet. We've got nice cloud coverage, which is fantastic, except Brian and I are not looking forward to when the sun eventually peeps through those clouds. I suspect it's going to be another scorcher of a morning, but come with me, I have something to show you. Brent, only 15 minutes. Yes, only 15 minutes. We'll have to have a hair flicking competition one of these days. Cheers, Brent. Good luck with the lions. So we'll probably go and help Brent search for the lions at some point. And off he goes with his long blonde hair. His hair's looking a lot blonder, don't you think? Almost the same color as mine, but not quite. Obviously that bleach blonde summer look that's so trendy with the boys these days. But come and have a look what I found behind a piece of bark. I need to see if I can find it again. But before I even get there, have a look at this web that you can see on the tree. Now, this web belongs to a spider that I saw disappear just up and underneath this little piece of bark. Let's see if I can try and pull it away. And it's actually a naughty little spider, this one. Not my favorite kind, and one that I often used to find in my ponchos that I'd keep in my cruiser or whatever. Here we go. Come and have a look here. Let's see. Yeah. Oh no, where's it gone? Let me just keep. Been very naughty. It's run away. No, come out and show everybody. No. Okay, well, it doesn't seem to want to be seen. It was running around earlier anyway, but you can see by its web, it makes a little sack. And you often see these against your curtains if you're in South Africa. And it's a spider known as a sack spider. So it's quite white in color, almost a creamish color, with a very, very dark black face. Now, it's a spider. It's not medically important like a violin spider. So if it bites you, you probably won't have to go to hospital. However, you need to make sure that you keep that wound nice and clean, because it has a cytotoxin in its venom, which causes necrosis. So when it bites you, what it will do is eventually the wound will go black and it will start to rot the skin. But because it's such a small, tiny little spider, you're probably not going to lose a limb. If you keep it disinfected and keep it clean at all times, you'll be probably quite fine. Now, I have been bitten by one of these, and my brother, for some bizarre reason, attracts sack spiders, and he's been bitten a number of times. So you don't need to be silly like him. At 16, he was in boarding school and he got bitten by one of these, and he sort of shrugged it off his shoulders and carried on with his day until he came back home on holiday and my mother noticed that he was limping. So of course, as a caring mother, said, "What's wrong? Why are you? What's happened?" She said, no, I just got bitten by a spider. So she thought, it's a bit suspicious, limping because of a spider bite. Well, he'd left it, and as a 16-year-old boy did, he didn't pay any attention to it. And yet she had to go to the doctor. And injection I took him, got a couple of anesthetic injections, and they had to cut away quite a bit of the flesh in the wound. But like I said, he didn't lose a leg, but he had a hole cut out of his leg about that big, probably about the size of a South African 5-rand coin or so. I want to see if I can find it. Brenda, good morning to you. Oh, I'm so sad the spider's gone inside its web again. Okay, I won't disturb it too much more. You were wondering if I've ever run into a venomous snake while being on a walk? Once. In 5 years, it's only ever happened to me once. And it's actually quite a funny story. So I was with a guide, and I think you may see him again, by the name of F.W. Evia. I used to work with him down in the southern Sabi Sands, and we'd gone on a walk together. And I was actually just backing him up with his guest. So he was on the lead walk, walking around. The next minute, we all come to a halt, and out of this grass nest. So in summer, the grass gets quite long, and the mice often make nests in the grass, so they weave it all down, and out came this big spitting cobra. So it just sort of sat up like that. It had obviously gone into this grass nest, hoping that a mouse that had made it was going to come back, and well, it was going to come back to a very, not a very exciting surprise, exciting for the snake. So it sat up, we all stood there, we backed away very slowly, and eventually the spitting Mozambique spitting cobra just crawled straight back into the nest in the grass, and well, we did a big round circle, we went the other way around. So that was quite an interesting experience. Otherwise, I've seen a couple of black mambas on game drive, which is, as we've seen, it's actually quite common. Other than that, not too many. You'd often see around the lodges sort of more the constrictors, so the brown house snakes and the spotted bush snakes, they're around, but they're not really anything to worry about. But what we're going to do now, we're going to carry on walking. We're actually going to change our route. We're going to go back east, and we're going to go give all the guards a hand and see if we can find these lions. Seeing as though we've got the best tracker in the field who's up in front, maybe we'll have a little bit of luck. And like I said, it'd be nice to give them a hand. So let's carry on going this way. We'll see if we can catch up to Herbert. But you know him, once he picks up on one track, there's no stopping him. Oh, there he is. Now, Diane, you're a little bit concerned about us being out here on foot. I promise you there's no need to worry. You were wondering what stops us from being attacked while we're out here. Well, common sense and a lot of training. Now, as you can imagine, when we are out in the bush and some of our training sort of behind the scenes that you unfortunately don't get to see is animal behavior is probably the most important thing, and then also picking up on the track and sign that the animals leave behind. So, first thing you should do when you're walking, you're never walking really quickly. It's a sort of slow, casual pace. We're in the bush. We're out here to appreciate the smaller things. And by doing that, you're able to see a lot more. Therefore, you would see a footprint that an animal would maybe leave behind. If you're lucky, some of the animals have strong scents to them. If you've got the wind blowing in your favor, you'll probably smell that. Otherwise, you always walk, especially when you go through thick bush, and you stop and you listen. You look around, you should be able to hear the crunching of an elephant pulling a branch or the shuffling of buffalo feet through the leaf litter, all those types of things. And when we're on foot, we don't want to get too close to the animals. Obviously, if there's maybe a natural drainage line between you or a big tree or something and it's safe to view the animal on foot, you do. But as you've seen on a number of occasions with the other guides, it's not for a long period of time. It's just for short little minutes, maybe 5 minutes, and then you move away. And then if it's a cat or something, then you call one of the guides in who have obviously in a vehicle and they can show their guests that way. And you all know how close we can get to the animals then. So on foot, it's to find the small things. And that's what we're hoping to do this morning, as well as hopefully find those cats for everybody else. We're going to shoot back across to Brent though and see if he's picked up on anything more.
Welcome back, guys. Sorry, I'm just on the Game Drive radio for a second. Negative, yeah, no, I didn't get any updates from Ngoro. Okay, so I can't copy Ngoro from here. I'm a bit too far. Maybe James can check. He's a little bit further to the east, I think. Okay, so we're looking for the lion tracks. And I'm hoping that they haven't crossed across our northern boundary. Oh, no sign of anything here. Now, Jan said the tracks were up ahead here somewhere around Tumburti Dam. So we're going to have a look there. Now, we're going to keep our eyes peeled. You never know. Quite often when you end up looking for lions, you spot a leopard, or vice versa. Now we have to be very careful on this road. It's going to be quite difficult to see the tracks unless they step in the, sort of the softer edges. Hippo tracks. Hippo, hippo, hippo. Now this is the area where Hans said he saw the first track, so I've slowed down a little bit, trying to make sure we don't miss any. So far, just that big hippo track you can see stretching up ahead. Some hyena tracks. Still no sign of the lions. Well, good morning, Ian and Kira, who are 9 and 6 years old. So wonderful to have you with us. Now, they'd like to know, are animals more or less active after the rain? Well, it depends on what animal you are. A lot of the birds will definitely be more active this morning, and also quite a few of the herbivores. Now, there's a bit of a green flush. They might get moving. But I'd say in general, as a general rule, a lot of animals are more active after the rain. So far, just hyena tracks and hippopotamus tracks. Maybe Johan was referring a little bit further to the east for the lion tracks. It's quite pleasant to have a slightly cooler morning. It means the lions, fingers crossed, are hopefully still on the move when we find them. Or if we find them. There are no guarantees in the live safari game. Voila! Here we go. So tracks of at least two adult lionesses. I don't see any tracks of the cubs just yet. There is one cub track there. But it's quite faint. Heading towards the east, fingers crossed they don't head to the north. Now it's amazing how nice and clear these tracks are. I would say pretty fresh sometime early this morning. So hopefully we're going to be able to find the kitty cats. Sometimes staring at the ground pays dividends. Okay, now, I'm gonna try figure out, the tracks are looping up and down and around here, so I'm gonna try do some investigating, see which way they go, but really, really exciting. James is with an animal that we haven't seen in quite a while.
There you can see a grey shape, everybody, an elephant, which is just too wonderful for words. I love seeing elephants, of course, especially when we don't see them all the time. But we're not alone here, and so although that shot of the elephant is a particularly poor one, and that is not on account of any incompetence on David's part, we do have another picture of the elephants, with any luck, from the air. And there you can see us, and you can see, with any luck, two elephant bulls, two young elephants, grazing their way through this recently moistened woodland. Can we see the elephants, Kirsten? We can kind of see the elephants. Okay, that's all right. I think Connor can probably come down a little bit. He can drop about 10 meters or so, and I think you'll probably get a slightly better view of them. There, you can see it zooming in on us slightly now. So this, of course, is a DC Teagues's first flight with animals and the drone. DC, of course, stands for Drone Commander. Did you get that? Well done, David. Oh, hooray, now we can see the elephants moving. That's excellent. And again, I mean, you saw how thick the bush looked from where we were sitting. We looked through a kind of impenetrable thicket of different kinds of trees. But from the air, you can see the trees are a lot more sparsely spaced than they look from the ground, and therefore, you can see the elephants. Now, with our new drone, eventually, we'll be able to zoom in on them from the air, which is marvelous. And you can see the drone, most importantly, is having no effect at all on the behavior of the elephants. And that's because Connor is being very sensitive with them as well. I'm just watching the clouds now moving in over the top of the drone. And it is quite amazing to watch the speed at which the clouds are moving with the drone there. Connor is being very brave about the distance that he's flying that thing. That's so cool. Ah, this is wonderful. So now you can see the elephants beautifully, and it's flying in quite a storm. I cannot see the elephants anymore. They've gone much too far away from us, so we can't see them at all. We're totally based on Connor's perspective of things here. So these bulls are now dispersed from the greater groups of elephants. The elephants, because there is standing water, there's food all over the place now, are starting to disperse around the place. And we're going to have less regular sightings of them. But that's just the way the summer goes, and that's absolutely fine. What a joy to see them from the air like that. Isn't that fantastic? Let's have one last look at the Wahlberg's eagle there. And that Wahlberg's eagle, I think, looks a little bit miserable sitting out watching the weather rolling in, and it's being bombed by white-crowned shrikes who seem to have left it alone now. It's watching the drone quite carefully. That's interesting. And, of course, we nearly lost this drone to a bateleur a little while back. Bateleur took great offence and gave it a bit of a smack. Beautiful. Now we're not going to move from this current position. We are going to probably go offline slightly for the next little while we try to fix our signal issues on young Jigger here. Dory, very good question. You say, is that drone loud? We can hear it. It's not what you would describe as silent, no. It sounds like an angry swarm of bees, and that's why we fly it very high up. And the idea is eventually, with the much more sophisticated drones, we'll have cameras that are able to sort of zoom in, like I was explaining, and we can fly them that much higher, and then you won't be able to hear them. The trick is, look, it's not a train smash that we can hear it. We know it's a drone, so it's not a train smash to hear the noise. It does become difficult, though, when animals start to react to it. And the idea is that animals don't react to it at all. It just becomes totally silent overhead view of the bush. And those elephants didn't react to it, which was great. We have had incidents. Of course, we've had to try it, where elephants do look up and they get a little bit upset. And so you've got to move away quite quickly because you do not want to be chasing animals with it. So, yes, we can hear it. Is it disturbing the animals? No, not at that height. I mean, Connor was probably... I think he was probably 70 meters or so up, so that's probably about 250 feet up into the air. So it just sounds like a fairly angry swarm of bees flying overhead. Right, Taylor McCurdy is out on foot. Let's go and find out what she's looking at right now.
So we've been turning up logs. We've been trying to find all sorts of different little creatures and critters to show you this morning, and well, Herbert, nothing is stopping him this morning. It seems as though the lions have crossed out the property. He found us a tiny little centipede. Can you see it there? I'm going to just try and move it just slightly. Don't go into a burrow. I'm going to see how big it really is. Come on. Now it's obviously quite tiny. I'm just trying to move the soil off it. There we go. It's a better view of it. Now it's really, really, really small. It's probably, I don't know, how big would you say that is, Brian? Tiny?
Tiny.
Tiny. We're going to use tiny as a form of measurement. And you can see that it's actually trying to burrow in and underneath the earth. Because it's so small, it's quite vulnerable. And even though they are armed with little fangs that will give you, or not fangs, but they'll give you a nasty little bite, and they can be venomous. I'm not sure what exactly this species of centipede is, but I'm sure there's a couple of hundred different ones. And I'm sure that it's probably going to try and get underneath the ground as quick as possible, because something like a little bird, perhaps a starling, oh, there it goes. That would be a lovely, delicious and nutritious meal. Well, that was the end of that. I'm going to put its little log back on top of it. There we go. Bye-bye, centipede. Okay, so we've got a request this morning, which is quite nice, and we might actually have a good chance of finding one of those. So James would like us to keep an eye out and see, another way sneaky, if we can find an African giant land snail. Now, I haven't seen one in such a long time. Hopefully I remember what they actually look like. And well, we know they're not the fastest moving creatures, so hopefully if we do find even its trail, maybe we'll be able to follow it and track it. We'll have to put Herbie's sort of test, his tracking skills to the test. Oh, look at this, a little millipede. This is what I love. You can literally, especially after the rains, just walk and walk and walk. Look at a shrub and look at this magnificent millipede that is crawling on the shrub. And you'll probably find that it maybe seeked a little bit of shelter underneath this sort of entanglement of branches. And now it's come out, but the seen as though the rain has disappeared. And this is probably one of the critters that we were talking about yesterday, and we were slightly concerned about which insects, particularly burrowing insects, will be affected by the rain and, get their burrows flooded. So I suspect it's come out of a burrow underneath the ground, or maybe underneath a fallen log, and come out to dry itself and probably look for something to eat. But we sort of do little signs, or whichever type of bird call you want to do. But that means that he's found something, so we're going to head over there, which is just a short walk away. And it sounds like it could be something excited because he's got a big smile. So let's go and have a little look and see what he's got for us. But it's lovely out here. It seems as though we've just had the perfect amount of rain. Not sure how much, probably just shy of maybe 10 mils, maybe even a little bit less than that. I could be giving it a bit more than what we actually had last night. But it's perfect. It was a soaking rain. The soil is nice and moist. It hasn't washed away any of the roads, which is wonderful. What have you got, Herbie? He's running after something, my goodness. Let's go around here. What did you get, Herbert? Trying to get a solifuge. Solly the solifuge. Oh, it's a big one. Oh, that is massive. So Herb, Herbert is, that's fine, Herbie. There we go, settle down now. Thank you. Well done, well spotted. That is massive. Oh my goodness. Right, I'm gonna try and move this. Where did he go?
He's just there, keep it there.
Okay, I'm not gonna move it. He is huge. He's probably about the length of my hand. I'm trying to see where he's gone, but that's okay, as long as you can see him. And if he does come running underneath this piece of marula tree, I'm probably going to scream. No, I'm just teasing. I won't do that. But this is a massive solifuge and quite fat, so I'm wondering if it's perhaps not a female, because we don't often see them so big and so plump. What do you think, Brian? Does it look quite fat to you?
I can't really see it.
Oh, must I move it a bit more? Oh, there it is. Oh, it's eating the termites. Come and have a look at this. So what's happened here, well, it was eating the termites, is that there's obviously quite a bit of fresh soil and the termites were living underneath this piece of marula wood, feeding away. So it disappeared again. Okay, we need to lift it again. And they love to eat termites. Now, I just don't want to get my finger nipped by anything. There it is. Coming back out again. Don't worry, I promise we will put it back again, but it's it's racing around. Oh my goodness, the solifuge is obviously not being very kind to Brian this morning, but you can just sort of see it there seeking a bit of shelter. So what we will do is we probably won't disturb it for too much longer. It looks as though it's not the happiest at the moment, and these solifuges are predominantly nocturnal, so probably a bit bright out here. Luckily, there's not a strong sun. Look at the lizard, the gecko, just on the underside of this. Can you see it? It's coming out. Look at what else we've just spotted that was living underneath the bark of this marula tree. Now, I'm trying to get a better view, but from over here, it looks like it's one of the geckos, maybe a tropical house gecko. And how I can tell that it is a gecko is that if you look at those toes, you can see how fat they are, and that's very, very typical of a gecko. Those big eyes, And they will also eat a number of different things. They'll eat spiders, so they're quite nice to have in your room. They'll eat moths. They'll eat grasshoppers. They'll really eat anything that they can catch. Look at that beautiful eye. Isn't that absolutely amazing? And it looks like quite a young one still. They can probably get to about 3 times the size that this one is. Probably this the length of your middle finger, if you use that, the longest finger on your hand. That's probably the length of it from the tip of its head and right down to its tail. And look at those lovely colorations that it has. Oh, there's another one. Look. Ah, okay, there was another one that was about 3 times that size, but it's now run away. This is exciting. It's amazing what you can find, though, all at one little sort of fallen over marula. Now, Brian, you were wondering if the gecko would eat the solifuge. Now, not this little one, and I don't know if they'd probably take on a solifuge of this size, but I suspect a solifuge that was maybe smaller, like some of the other little ones that we've seen, would probably, of course, definitely take an opportunity to eat something like that. Now, I can't tell you how much is actually going on over here. We've obviously got this beautiful gecko that's just staring away at us, enjoying its debut on Safari Live. And I must admit, it's the first gecko I've seen since I've been here. I haven't seen too many of them. My favorite is actually when you see them walking up on the glass on a window, and you can look at them from the other side. Sometimes you can actually see the inside of the organs. Now, M. Ruth, you were wondering what the differences are between a chameleon and a gecko. So if you look at a chameleon, the most obvious thing that you see as it disappears is they've got those big, beautiful eyes which they are able to rotate around. Also, they have eyelids. They are able to blink. I don't know if you noticed, but that entire time that we were looking at that gecko, did you see it blink once? Brian, did you see it blink? Didn't see it blink at all. Not all those gecko species have eyelids. Some of them actually have to stick their tongues out onto their eyelid to remove the debris and pop it back in. So that's one of the differences, is their eyes. Also, straight away you can see that their feet are completely different structure. So geckos, they've got little sort of, I suppose you could say, hooks on the underside of the pads on their feet, which allows them to grip onto all sorts of things and walk up different surfaces. Whereas a chameleon probably wouldn't be able to walk up a window. It'd be a little bit too steep for them. So chameleons are different, and chameleons are also very lateral, vertical and sort of lateral and compressed, so that when a bird or something is flying overhead, they look down onto the branch, and the chameleon sort of fits in quite nicely with the branch, whereas a gecko or any of the lizards are sort of quite flat and robust compared to a chameleon. So there's a little bit of a difference in that. They've got a bit more camouflage, it will allow them to blend right in, but up on a flat surface, whereas a chameleon, along with its very slow, jagged movements and it being laterally compressed, it's hidden from the top and of course from the side. Lizards unfortunately don't have that benefit. But I want to try and see if I can put this piece of bark back and see if we can get Sally the, well, probably not, maybe Sally the solifuge, because I think it could be a female. We probably want to put her back, and I also want to put the termites back where we found them. So let me lift up and you might get one last view. Oh, it's making a burrow. Look at that. You can see it's trying to burrow out a little spot there. Herbie, do you think you can help me lift this piece of wood? And I want to take it back. Get Herbert to come and assist me very quickly. And what we're going to do now is this going to take a bit of maneuvering, but I want to leave the solifuge alone now. I don't want to disturb it for too much longer. But let's hop across back in Brent's vehicle and see what he's got for you.
Sad, sad news. The incredible Inkahumas have gone to Buffalo's Hook. So their tracks did cross north around Gari Cutline. We've headed further down the boundary just in case they might have looped back in, but we've arrived at, or we're about to arrive at the Buffalo's Hook waterhole, and there's no sign of their tracks coming back in. But you never know, they might have crossed just to the east of us. So let's have a look at what could be at the waterhole. Jandre, any guesses? A walrus. I guess that will be a new one. Good morrow, Gregory. Gregory would like to know, are there any crocodiles or alligators here? There are no alligators. Alligators are a species confined to the Americas. We do have crocodiles. Now, we have seen crocodiles on the drives before, but the crocodiles will move between water holes that are holding water, and I don't think there are any crocodiles in any of our water holes presently. There's just maybe not enough water. But the only way to be sure you are never bitten by a crocodile in Africa is to assume every puddle has a crocodile. Now we've arrived, and there is... Oh no, there's goslings! Okay, so in the Keep coming. There. A little bit up. Watch my finger. There. You got them? There we go. How many? Wow! Egyptian goose. One, two, three, four. What? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Are they 11? I think that's the biggest group of Egyptian goose goslings I've ever seen. Let me just double check. 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, 8. Oh, they move too much, you little blighters. 1. Oh, joy. Oh, there's a lot. I think I got 11. Trouble while they dash around. Okay, let's try again. No, no, you're mixing up again. And disappear. The Egyptian geese are able to raise the goslings. It must have been hatched in the last day or two. It's the first time I've seen goslings at the Buffalo Support. There's no mammals here, but we do have a few interesting and is off. We come back towards the edge and to the right slide. Difficulties, so we're going to jump across to Taylor.
Look at this tiny little scorpion that we've picked up that was on the ground. It is also, it's minute. It's probably the size of your thumbnail. And this tiny little scorpion is called an olivaceous scorpion. So it's a olive bark scorpion. It's a very small one still, but don't let the size fool you. Dynamite definitely comes in small packages, as you can see. And the reason that I know that it's one of the olivaceous scorpions, the olive bark scorpion, is if you look at its colouring, it's olive sort of green, that's a giveaway. But there's a few little scorpions that look like this. But if you have a look at its pincers, you can see how tiny they are. And if you look at its tail, look how thick that tail is, that little venom sac over there. Now, we all know that the thicker the tail, the smaller the pincers, the deadlier the bite. When I say bite, I actually mean the sting, the venom that comes out of there. So this one I'm definitely not going to pick up with my hands, though I'm not quite as brave as what Scott and all of them are. I'm not going to pick a scorpion up. So I think what we're going to do is I'm probably going to put it back now. I just want to put it back closer towards a tree. So let's head this way and see if we can put it down. And it's actually quite relaxed with us, which is really, really nice to see. And I haven't seen one of these little guys in such a long time. I think the last time I found one, and I may have told this story before, I'm gonna just pop it in over here, just keep it hidden so that it doesn't get eaten by anything. Now, the last time that I saw one, it was quite interesting. I was sitting in my room, and I apologize if I've told this story. I have a goldfish memory occasionally. And just sitting reading a book on my bed, and it didn't happen here. It happened at the other place I used to work. And well, the next moment, something caught my attention behind my head and at the curtain. So I looked like this, turned my head, It was the biggest olive bark scorpion I've ever seen, sitting right at my head. It had crawled in off a tree and through the window. It was one of those hot days like we're experiencing now. It was about a year ago, I think. And it was obviously coming inside the room to try and keep nice and cool. But I put it back outside, and it was actually quite an obliging scorpion. It wasn't too aggressive or anything, so I did a little photo shoot with it and got some nice macro photos. And well, then it carried on its way up a knobthorn, and off it went. And that's often some of the trees that you'll see those olive bark scorpions, is either marula trees or the knobthorn trees, and a variety of others. But you know what we're going to do in a moment is we've come onto this massive open plain now, and I think we're going to send the drone up somewhere around there. So here, it's just going to be a couple of moments, but isn't that quite exciting that we're able to pull the drone out and start utilizing more on a regular basis? I think it's quite amazing, and it gives us an amazing bird's eye view, and it really shows you just how small we actually are. Oh, I can hear some impala. Don't know if we'll be able to see them, but they're racing around. It's a male chasing a female. And it always amazes me how persistent the boys are out here in the bush. They don't give up. The courtship process, sort of, nothing really puts them down and bruises their ego. They carry on until they get what they need to get. But he's chasing her around, which is a bit strange to see at this time of the year. But maybe it's a young ewe. Maybe she's about to come into estrus for the first time or so. Or, I don't know, still getting the feel of what it's like to be in a herd. And, well, we just actually picked up on some lovely tracks here. And it may probably be the exact same herd of impala that we've just seen. So if you have a look here. Oh, I've got such a fright, it was the drone that I can hear. So if you have a look down over here, let's do this one. Look at that wonderful little footprint we've got. Very, very sort of heart shape, very narrow at the tip, and look like it was just a normal gate, just a normal walking gate. The sand is very, very soft here. This is amazing, the drove is above us now. We're gonna change soon. That's incredible. I have to look up and wave. Wow. That's amazing. Well, we're going to keep going. And Herbert said he's found something else, which is going to be a little bit difficult because I don't quite think that the drone is going to be able to see down here. But what I am going to do is I'm going to walk on an animal pathway just to show you a little pathway that most likely something like an impala or maybe a wildebeest are using. So as you see, you'll probably see it quite nicely from up above. You should see that it's a little bit sandy. You can see Herbert, you have to wave. And I love these little pathways, and we obviously only get one sort of angle to look at these pathways from when we're on the ground, and that's sort of our eye view. But it's nice to see how these networks sort of split as we're walking. And this isn't a very prominent pathway though. Hopefully we'll find some better ones, and most of them will actually lead to water. And I suspect if we were to follow this one for a couple of minutes, we'd probably get and head back towards the Juma Dam. It might split off into a couple more. Like, we're actually going to get to a bit of a crossroad now. Let's see, which road are we going to take? What do you think, Brian? Should we go straight? Should we go? We've come to basically a fork in the road. You can see standing here, and we're going to carry on straight. That one goes off somewhere else. Maybe there's a nice shrub, good place to eat. I'm not sure, but we'll stick onto this one. The weather is just perfect for a walk. Lovely cool breeze. It's so wonderful. Now I wonder if Connor can see anything. Ah, very nice. So up, up, up and away Connor goes. That's incredible. So apparently it's looking quite dry from up the top, but hopefully after this little bit of rain that we've just had, the green grass is going to come through. And I must say, it's quite deceiving when you look on this big open plain, because there is not a lot of grass actually. There's all these different types of sort of weeds and plants that are sprouting up on this open plain. So hopefully the grass is going to have an opportunity to actually poke through and start to be able to spread its roots and make some turf down here. Oh, we've got another millipede again. They seem to be out and about at the moment. Should we see if we can pick this one up? No. Okay, I'm not going to pick him up. He doesn't want to be touched. He's gone into his little defensive ball. You can see straight away, they don't have eyes. He touched my hand. It felt a foreign object and didn't quite like what it felt. So automatically, it curled itself up into a little ball. And what it could also do is excrete a substance, which is very smelly. And as most of you will know, contains a small amount of cyanide. So I'll rather leave him and not disturb him too much. And I'm sure, here you go, uncurls himself, and off he goes on his day, looking for some leaves to feed on. Right, I believe though that Brent has made it towards, made it towards Buffalo's Hook Dam. Let's go and see what's happening there.
Well, there we go. The wind has picked up. The weather's taken a change. I thought it was going to clear. Of course, the weather has proved me wrong yet again. Now, there we go for our birders. A lovely little wader looking for aquatic invertebrates to feed on. So damselfly larvae, mayfly larvae, dragonfly larvae. And hopefully for that little critter, and there's lots to be found. Now, I think it's time to get the grey matter moving, and who can tell me what bird species this is? And if you know what bird this is, use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or pop us an email to questions@wildearth.com. It
seems as though the marula trees are the most popular ones today with all the insects and things. You can see this big marula tree was pushed over probably a couple of years ago, and over the last few years it's been deteriorated and eaten by anything, well, that it eats decaying matter. But Brian spotted these lovely white things, and I actually think that you may be seen these before, but come down and have a look over here. Look at this. So this is a little egg. Let me try that again. This is a little egg, and it's most likely an egg from a lizard of some sort. And the reason why I don't think it's a snake is that it's because it was laid sort of probably up and underneath the bark, whereas the snakes will probably try and bury their eggs if they can. But it's lovely, very sort of, let's see if I can pick up the other one. No, crumbling away. Okay, I won't try and pick it up. But sort of quite long, almost elongated, and the shell is so thin and so delicate. But that could also be because it's probably quite old and been baking in the sun. And of course, all that calcium that is used to make the egg is probably now quite brittle and crumbling away. But it's just incredible, all this wood around here. I was hoping to find maybe another scorpion or so, but it seems as though I think everything is sort of left away. So we'll carry on. Let's see if this marula tree is dropping any fruit just yet. Looks like it could be a female marula tree. It's because there's nothing really growing at the base, and we'll see if we can find some old seeds here. Not yet. Yes, here we go. So it's only the females that bear fruit, as I'm sure you probably remember. This is an old seed that you can see. And some of the marula trees have actually started dropping some fruit already, but just really small ones. I think I remember showing you some probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago now. And they're not ripe yet. They'll even sit on the ground for a couple of days. They won't ripen at all. It's bizarre how sometimes these trees, they do as like a defense mechanism almostly. They just drop a little seed. It doesn't matter how big the seed is. If it gets underneath the ground and it gets a bit of water, it'll probably grow. And like I said, with those fruits not really being ripe, I don't think too much is going to feed on them. But this is a particularly large marula. But we'll see if we can find some some fruits, and maybe what I'll do, just as a test, I'll take them, I'll pick them up off the ground, and we'll probably try and keep them away from the animals and see if they do ripen. And if they do, we'll see if we can taste them and see what they taste like. But I suspect with there being a lack of water, they'll probably be quite bitter and not very tasty at all. And well, unfortunately, we should only, well, not fortunately, we should only start seeing those marulas dropping in about February or so. It's very, very, very early at the moment. Having a little scan around. Now, even though we have come to this big open plain, and you shouldn't become sort of complacent with your environment, because yes, you can see everything around you, but when you're on these open plains, you don't have a lot of cover, and that obviously cannot be your friend. So if you're walking and a big herd of buffalo or elephants came out into the open for you, there's only a couple of places that you could really go. Luckily, we've got some nice termite mounds and a couple of big trees, but it's always good to be extra vigilant when you are out in the open. But we're just going to carry on. See, Herbie's digging away under a tree, seeing if he can find anything. And I'm actually surprised with what we've seen, because it's a little bit more chilly. Like I said, it's a nice cool day. So I didn't think that we were going to see too many insects along the way. But I think that's because we've had all that lovely new rain that's helped us out a little bit. What you got, Herbie? Herbie's playing charades, I'm not sure, but he did something like this and then pointed to the ground. I don't know what that means, but we'll go and have a look, and then hopefully next time he does that, I'll know straight off the bat what he was talking about. Oh my goodness, look, it looks like the elephants have had a good go at this tree and stripped the bark. But it seems to be doing all right. Nyala. Young kudu. Okay. Look at this. So, Herbie. Sorry, I thought I was hearing something. No, it's the drone again. So we've got a pair of horns. And, well, they look to be two different sizes. Herbie looks like a young kudu, but you could easily get confused and maybe call it a Nyala horn. Because an Nyala horn, being in the same family as the kudu and as the bushbuck, the Trachelaphus, the spiral-horned antelope family, well, their horns sort of curve the shape, especially when they start out young, those kudu. But I suppose if you look at the density and the thickness of these horns, they might just be a little bit too large for something like an Nyala. That would be a very impressive Nyala bull though. But I'm probably going to put them back here. It looks very old, and there's not too many other remains of this kudu. Right. Dust the hands off. Covered in dust and sand and soil and all sorts of things, so I need to dust my knees off. But I believe that James is not too far away. Let's go across and see where he is.
I'm not too far away at all. We had to do some running repairs on old Jigger here. She's back up and running. You may notice also that I am wearing a jersey or a jacket, and that is because, well, there's a bit of precipitation in the air. There's a bit of a cool breeze blowing through, so I think maybe we might have a little bit of rain. Let's go and have a look at us from the air. There we go, everybody, and you can see that we're now driving past Herbert. Good morning, Herbert. Ahe, Mjana Kwalan. We are driving past Taylor and Brian, and now we're going to leave them to the elements, and we're going to head off towards the western side of Quarantine Clearings. And then what we have in front of us, believe it or not, are some impala. Can you see any impala? Impala to the north of the vehicle, sorry, to the west of the vehicle. A whole beautiful herd of them. And they're off on the left-hand side of the car. We will have a look at them just now. And I'm going to go around to the western fringes of this clearing to see if we can't maybe pick up on those dog tracks that Brent had earlier on today. There we going to do a little sortie along to the main access road and then head down towards the western fringes. A little bit of precipitation dropping on my head, hitting me in the face. David, are you regretting your decision not to bring a jacket? A little bit. Shame. Sorry for you. I'll lend you my jacket, David, except you're a bit big compared with I. Yes. Where should we turn? Where should we go? Where should we go? Oh, let's go this way. Okay, good. There we are. So what you're looking at, of course, is Combretum woodland. And that Combretum woodland is the dominant vegetation type of this area. And if you look off to the left-hand side of the car, what you can see up onto the crest areas, the soil becomes a lot more. And you can see the big tall trees there, the thicker. Sorry about that, I think we lost our voice for a second there. Anyway, just so nice to have that extra view, and so nice that I can explain in more depth about where we're sitting and sort of what we're seeing. Now, I'm going to ask Connor to try and follow us around here, simply because there could be wild dogs in this area. So let's see, I'm not sure how much battery he's got, but let's see if he can't stick with us for a little bit longer, and staying on the left-hand side of the vehicle, so off to that side in those clearings, and maybe he'll be lucky to spot some dig-dags. I don't believe I just said that. What the hell is a dig-dag? That is impressive. Oh well. Very blustery indeed. And it's swirling cloud. I don't see anything through here. Now, I was talking a little bit about the vegetation, and what we're going through here is a seep line, and this is another one of my favorite little patches. If we stop here, and just have a listen and see if we can't hear any alarm calling or anything like that, off to the right-hand side here, Darby, you can see a seep line, and it is distinguished, of course, by these very, very pretty parkland of silver cluster leaf trees. Now, Jay, you're wondering about eagles in the drone and whether they might attack it or not. Look, it's possible. We have had an incident where a battalier had a go at it. And so we do want to try and avoid that. So we'll try and avoid flying too close to birds that might attack it. Certainly birds that are known to grab things in the air. But what is interesting is that we have followed vultures with the drone, and vultures don't seem to react in anything like the same way as the battalier did. And so you can actually get amongst the vultures, and it's quite astounding to be at a vulture sort of view level. It really is very special indeed, and I'm hoping that we're going to be able to do much more of that going forward. Now, there's some alarm calling rollers in here and starlings. That's off to the right-hand side of the picture that you can see now, or the right-hand side of us, if we are in the picture, which I think we are. So you can look to my right. I can see the drone now. Nothing very obvious has turned up there. Right, and that's going to be it from the drone. I think they're probably just about run out of battery. We might have one last look, I'm not sure. So the plan now to head to the western sector and see, oh, there's a battalier. Beautiful battalier as it flies overhead. I don't know which way it's going to turn, so whether we're going to be able to look at it or not, we're not. It's flown out of view. Brent Leo Smith, however, has another similar kind of death from above.
Oh, look at this. Isn't this a beautiful big bird doing a bit of preening? Now, as you know, the true eagles or Aquila eagles, there's a few of them that can look quite similar. This being one of them. Now we're going to go through why it is what it is. Now, even though the light's quite bad, we're looking at the two distinguishing features here are the gape and the eye. Now, the gape I'm talking to about is the mouth. So the gape of this eagle extends to behind the eye, and also it has dark brown eyes, or brown eyes as opposed to pale eyes or yellow eyes. Now that tells us exactly which of the Aquila or true eagles it is. Now also you can see that there's feathers all the way down to those massive talons on the feet, and also they're quite baggy leggings, you would call them, so on the feet. So that immediately rules out a couple of the others. So out of the dark brown eagles of this size, the two most common to get quite confused at this time of the year is the steppe eagle and the lesser spotted eagle. Now the lesser spotted eagle has narrow, almost like stovepipe, well, let's put it into hipster terms, the lesser spotted eagle wears skinny jeans, and this, the steppe eagle, wears Thai fisherman pants. So much baggier feathers around the legs, and a gape that extends beyond the eye, and the baggy pants tell us that this is a steppe eagle. Now, as we know, the steppe eagles migrate from the steppes. The steppes of where, you ask? Well, the steppes of Russia and Central Asia, north of the Himalaya Mountains, and they do travel incredible distances to be here. So they breed in Ukraine and Central Asia, and all north of the Himalayas, most importantly, and then they move through India and all the way down to South Africa, throughout Southern Africa. They seem to skip over East Africa and spend their summer months here. They can arrive as early as October, November, but normally end of November, December. Now, where there are massive amounts of termite emergences, there have been flocks of up to 800 steppe eagles seen, and amongst them, of course, always the lesser spotted eagles, black kites, and the biggest roost ever recorded in Southern Africa was about 20,000, 25,000 steppe and lesser spotted eagles. That was in the Chobe National Park in northern Botswana. Now, believe it or not, even though they do eat things, rodents and birds, especially red-billed quillias where there's massive flocks, about 60 to 70% of their diet at this time of the year is termite alates. And the favorite food of them is the northern harvester termite. So the big one we see running around on the ground, we saw someone bushwalk yesterday. And one single pellet from a steppe eagle can contain up to 1,000 termite heads. And they've got to eat a lot of termites to get their required protein for the day. And normally they will eat probably about 200 termites a day. And that normally takes about 3 hours of heavy feeding. Okay, so we're staying pretty close to home today, because it seems as soon as we wander, we get some technical difficulties. Yeah, well, let's go carry on up to the top of quarantine. See if we can find any more gorgeous birds. Hello, Miss Dent. And Miss Dent would like to know, are there any birds, very rare birds, that we don't see? Well, fortunately for me, I'm a very avid bird watcher. So in southern Africa, very, very few birds outside of some of the sea birds and sort of offshore birds that I haven't seen. But there are local rarities that I love to see. So I went chasing, it was about 2 years ago, there was a report of an Egyptian vulture in the Kruger. Now, they hadn't been seen for a very long time, so I raced there. Unfortunately, I wasn't in time, but I've seen Egyptian vultures in East Africa, in Kenya and in Tanzania, but I've never seen one in South Africa. So there's a rare bird that I would probably start spinning if we saw. Now, of course, there's also always local rarities, so birds you don't often find in the area, although they have been seen before. Summer months, there's always an outside chance at a European honey buzzard in this area. That would be a really good one. And then other birds that might occur in different parts of the Sabi Sands, but not here, like a gorgeous bushshrike, which generally occurs down where there's more riverine area, so bigger rivers. I'm trying to think what else. I mean, we got the broad-billed roller finally after nearly 2 years. So that was quite exciting for me, at least, and I know for a lot of our birding fans. But I'm trying to think. I'll think about a few other birds. Ooh, Madagascar and lesser cuckoo. I'm still convinced, because of the erratic rains this year, that there's going to be one seen somewhere in the Sabi Sands, and fingers crossed it's the north. But while we continue to look for birds, and I'll think about a few more rare bird species we can look for, let's jump across. Oh, actually, let's jump off the car onto foot with Taylor.
Now, you have to look very, very carefully at this little creature that we found sitting on a small plant, and it's wobbling quite a bit in the wind. And this is a very cryptic praying mantis. Can you see that? I haven't seen one of these praying mantis in such a long time, and it's not very often that you see them with this beautiful and this different type of coloration. Now, normally the ones we see are those, the typical African mantis, the green ones. And they get quite large, but these little ones can get quite big. This is most likely, lots of wind today. This is most likely a little nymph. And basically when the little mantises hatch, they hatch into little sexless nymphs. And when I say nymph, that means that it's almost an exact replica of the adult. And well, it doesn't have any wings just yet, but it will molt about 7 times. And then eventually it'll become an adult. Isn't that lovely? Now, these are incredible little creatures, and they've got they're actually quite easy to identify. Firstly, because of the way they've got their front legs sort of look almost looks like they are praying. That's why they're called the praying mantis, that little shape that they've got on their legs there. And then also, they've got a very triangular head, two big compound eyes on either side. And they're almost able to rotate their head at about 180 degrees. Isn't that quite incredible? So now they're able to do that. And can you believe it? Their eyesight is actually quite good as well. Probably better than mine. And no, not really. But they can see up to about 15 meters. Isn't that amazing that they're able to do that? I actually want to have one last look at it. So, Orthon, you thought that this was a leaf. It kind of does look a little bit like a leaf. I'm going to try and go as low down as I can, just because I didn't really get a great look at it. Look, that's just absolutely amazing. Bits of white, a little bit of purple coming up on the legs as well, on the little joints. It almost looks as though it's trying to mimic a flower of some sort. And I reckon if this little chap were to sit on the flowers known as a string of stars, some of you may have known that, and maybe we see some today, I think that would camouflage very well with the very sort of star-like white flowers that they have growing on them. But they're incredible little things, and completely carnivorous, so they just catch things like crickets, probably ants and other little insects at this size. But you can get some really, really big ones. Remember that gecko we saw earlier? There's some massive species all over the world. There's some 2,000 species of praying mantis, and some of those would get large enough to be able to take down a big gecko like the one that we saw earlier this morning. Isn't that beautiful? And look who's come to join us again. We are being followed by the millipedes today. It seems as though they want to try and get in every single shot. Yeah, it's crawling through here. And I think that that is actually quite amazing. Little praying mantis sitting up above, looking down below on this millipede as it uses its ganglia, the little sensors, little feelers on the top of its head to move around and, well, not to bump into anything. Are you having some trouble looking for something to eat? I wonder what it's doing. Let's get to an obstacle now. Let's see what it does. If it's going to go over the stick, probably just go over. It's not really a big obstacle. And, well, those little legs help them grip as well. I always find it's amazing how they're able to walk on our hands and not fall off all the time. Isn't that lovely? Now, I think I found the string of stars, actually. Looks like it. Have a look over here, Brian. It's a tiny one. It's actually quite a difficult one to see. But can you see the little flowers just starting to develop? Those tiny little white ones? That is what I was talking about. This is obviously minute, though. And, well, when they grow, those flowers will probably triple in size. They'll be a little bit bigger. And you can see that that praying mantis would camouflage beautifully on the sleeve. But it's incredible what you can find and what you see. My mom never was very impressed with me taking all the spiders and things home, but that was me with all sorts of jars filled with all sorts of creatures that lived in my room. That's not the case anymore though, and let's go and see what Mr. Hendry is now up to this morning.
I am now heading towards Treehouse Dam in the hopes that something will be there. We saw a couple of impala, but I'm afraid that, from a mammal point of view, has been about it. David, there, I believe, in front of us is the same batalea that we were looking at. Let me stop the car, because then at least you can get a picture. There we are. I do love that sound, isn't it nice? It's like listening to the Ode to Joy. And now it's gone. Okay, never mind. Let's continue towards Treehouse Dam and see if we aren't very lucky over there. Oops, sorry, that was the wrong pedal. I hit the brake instead of the clutch. David nearly lost his two front teeth. What I meant to do was put my foot on both the brake and the accelerator. Because you see, if we do this for long enough, what happens is the squeaking goes away because the brakes get hot. There we are. Fixed. Fixed the problem. But on a blustery day like today, as I'm sure Brendan Taylor probably said to you, of course animals like to hide because it is easy for the predators to come and eat them. Go down towards the dam. What I can say is that to the east it looks to me like it's brightening up, so maybe this front is temporary. I'd rather hope that it wasn't going to be temporary because, well, it's been so very, very hot of late. It's very nice to have this cloud cover. Nearly hit a spider hunting wasp. The other thing that I've been looking for is a decent tree from which to retrieve the lighted matches, which of course are those mistletoe flowers that are just starting to come up now. They're really quite pretty. I'll stop here briefly and look off to the right-hand side. Many of you will know, of course, of my relatively sort of strong obsession with the baboon's tail, Xerophytoretinervis. That's these plants here. Now, they have been very subdued over the last, say, 4 or 5 days because there's been so little in the way of rain. But now, just with that probably half an inch or maybe a little bit more than that we had last night of rain, they've suddenly popped up. And the leaves, although they're yellow, are going to start to turn green. The capillary action of the tiny little tubes that make up those kind of baboons' tails will be sucking the water out of the surface of the soil now. And they're going to produce flowers, I imagine, very soon. So I suspect that by the time we drive past here this afternoon, those yellow leaves will be green. They're quite remarkable, these plants. They go dormant when there's no water, and as soon as the water is back, they go green. I was going to tell you what I heard of Mary's question. Do you get cottonwood tree frogs? I don't think that was the question. Do we get cotton here? Yes, we do get cotton, actually. We get a wild cotton, not cottonwood trees, no. But we do get cotton trees, or cotton plants, Gossypium herbaceum. And I saw one the other day, in fact it wasn't far, I know exactly where it is. Let's go and look. It's not often that you race off to a cotton tree, is it, David? Exactly where it is, it's not far from here, but before we go there, let's have a look at these impalas. Hello, impalas. Are you enjoying the weather? Oh, no, not so much. Oh, well, I don't blame you, really. I suppose for you, this is a tough time. But I can tell you, impalas, that the Nkuhuma pride is on Biffle's Hook, so you don't have to worry about them. Karula, I think, is probably eating your cousin in southern Gowri. You don't need to worry about her. Tringana, however, I cannot vouch for his position, so I would watch out for him. Watch out for him. Yes. Good. He's looking very regal for the camera. You see that? I think he's posing. They really are quite special things, these. Now what's interesting is that you will read that impala like this will turn towards the wind in order to smell what's coming with the wind. But these chaps have done exactly the opposite. It might be the sight of DC Connor Teagues that's arrested their attention. Oh, that's very good show jumping there. You see that, David, from a standstill. Excellent. I don't know why, I'm reminded of a video I saw once. While we look at those impala jumping over logs of a woman, I don't know in what context it was, but she entered an animal into a show. It was a show jumping show of a very sort of gentle class, you know, so it wasn't a big A-grade class. It was a very sort of novice class. And she entered the arena riding a Friesland cow. And the sight of a human being dressed in the full regalia of a sort of show jumping, formal show jumping attire on the back of a Friesland cow was somewhat amusing, to say the least. If you're looking for a pick-me-up, I would suggest you go and YouTube that particular video. It was very funny. I don't think the cow was very good jumping at all, but there it is. Right, so let's carry on to our cotton tree. Ladybugs and daisies, you're wondering if impala are ruminants. They are most certainly ruminants. All the antelope out here are ruminants. The entire family of them are ruminants. In fact, they belong to an order of ruminants. The even-toed ungulates, all. No, that's not true. Most of them are ruminants. So pigs, of course, are even-toed. They are not ungulates at all. At least they are not ruminants at all. But all of the 9 species of antelope we get here, buffalo, giraffe, they are all ruminants. And if you're wondering what a ruminant is, well, it's like a cow. It has a 4-chambered stomach, and it has to re-chew its breakfast, something that I'm very grateful that I do not have to do. I suppose one better than the poor old scrub hare, who has to eat its own dung. David just went pale. We're coming up, everybody, on the sighting of the morning, Gossypium herbaceum, the wild cotton plant. I think it was on this termite mound. If it wasn't, I'm going to be very embarrassed. It is. It is not. I could have sworn blind it was here. This is very distressing, everybody. I thought there was a cotton plant where this groovier plant is. It must have been another termite mound. I will do my level best to find, Mary, a cotton plant for you during the rest of this morning. It seems that all the predators are not around, so why not look for cotton plants which are unable to move, although they do seem able to hide. This is, of course, the Groovia bicolor, and it's called bicolor. Why, David?
It's two colors.
That's right, it is two colors. You see, it is darker on the front than it is on the back. Yes, fascinating fact of the day. Let us continue on our search for Gossypium herbaceum. Now, I may have told you the story of Gossypium herbaceum before, but there was a wonderful student I had when I was working up north of here for about 200 kilometers or so, and I was teaching about 25 unemployed, poorly educated rural people, wonderful people. All of them had high school qualifications. But they were totally clueless. They'd been very poorly educated, and so we were doing conservation work, and we were learning about trees and that sort of thing. And they said to me, well, I mean, you know, they weren't first language English speakers, and so for them to learn the English names of trees was just as difficult as learning the Latin ones. And so we just did both. And I remember I sent them off to a tree course after we'd been doing our trees for about a month or so. And our ladies, three ladies, fantastic, went off to this tree course, and the tree examiner was there sort of explaining things, and he kind of imperiously pointed over at a tree and said, does anybody know what that is? You know, expecting no one to know and to say, oh great guru, do tell us. At which point Evidence Shikwambu, that was her name, Evidence Shikwambu looked at him as though he'd stepped from a piece of cheese and said, that, sir, is Gossypium herbaceum, the wild cotton. And apparently he fell over. I felt a great swelling of pride in my chest. She looked at him as though he was a complete idiot for asking her what tree that was. That, sir, is Gossypium herbaceum, the white cotton. In many parts of this country, as we continue to talk about cotton on the absence of anything else, cotton was attempted as an agricultural plant, and it wasn't the local variety, because the local variety produces... there was a squirrel, but it's run away. The local variety produces very little cotton, and so it is hybridized often. David, there's a water buck. It does hybridize with the wild variety. Oh my goodness, what a shot that is, hey? Astounding. Now there is one of the ruminants that we have here. He is not ruminating at the moment, obviously. That would be far too convenient for the narrative story of this drive. He is simply blinking and snoozing. But I'm sure he was ruminating. and he's decided he's going to stay in bed today. Now, Connor is going to try and find us in the drone. I can hear him. It sounds like the bees are just overhead. He needs to come to the north and east. He's currently going southwest, Kirsten, which means he's not going to see us. It's starting to warm up now, which is quite nice, and I think that that waterbuck will go off grazing fairly soon. I was trying to learn something more about waterbuck because, of course, we've got through all the standard facts about these things, and we see them relatively regularly, and the factoid I came up with, believe it or not, is that they are, in fact, 13 subspecies of the waterbuck. Did you know that, David?
No.
I bet you didn't. I didn't either. Now, there are two major groups, one the Defassa group, which occurs up in East Africa, and one the common that occurs up down here. And between those two major groupings, they are divided into 13 subspecies. I couldn't begin to tell you what they're all called or where they all are, but there you are. That is my waterbuck factoid of the day, and I will attempt to come up with a new factoid every time we see a waterbuck. I'm sure now you're all falling off your chairs with astonishment at the factoid I've just given you. I think Connor has flown his drone most of the way to Cape Town, so we're going to carry on from here. Kirsten, I can hear it to the south of us, but I'm afraid the sound of humming bees is getting further away. I'm now going past all the termite mounds I know of, looking for Gossypium herbaceum. Slightly confused as to why it wasn't on the termite mound. I thought it was. There's another one up here it might be on. It's impossible camera with mass seasickness amongst the audience. Right, Brent Leo Smith is back online. Let's go and find out what's going on with his tracking. I am going to tell you, however, that he has a sad story, I think, to tell.
Well, we're tracking flowers quite successfully for the fact that there's not too many flowers around at the moment. Now, we have wing-seeded wild sesame. It's quite a sad-looking sesame flower. I'm going to sit next to it. Hopefully, it'll feel better and start growing more. So there we go. There it is. Wing-seeded sesame. Now, of course, it's related to the sesame that you normally get. Now, you can create fuel out of this. When I talk about fuel, of course, I'm talking about cooking oil. You can make cooking oil out of this. They do it in Tanzania quite successfully. Another interesting fact about this wonderful little wing-seeded sesame. Hello, Taxon. How are you, Umfo? We're causing a traffic jam, but I'm just going to get comfortable. Yeah, hello, Taxi. I'll move for him now. Is that it is another African equivalent of the little blue pill. For boys. So when mixed with milk, it generally thickens and becomes a very nice yogurt-like drink. So it generally becomes a very nice yogurt-like drink, and it takes about a day or two. And drinking that is said to be very effective on men who have problems in that department. The wing-seeded sesame, or wild sesame. Now, it's has been grown. I've seen it grown in southern Tanzania and rural Tanzania to create sesame oil. You actually need a lot of it. So they don't only press the seeds, they press the whole plants and root systems. Now, like a lot of the wildflowers, they only grow for a short time, and they are during the rainy season. So it's a lot of work to get any oil out of the sesame plants. Okay, and let's carry on. Now, because I've decided it's not a gremlin this morning, there's definitely an alien up there. I'm pulling wires on the satellite. So we're trying to stick a little bit close to home, and I'm trying to focus on any little flowers we might be able to find. Ooh, hello, hello. Oh, it's got another little flower here. Now, what do we have here? Now, you've got to be quite careful because the yellow flowers, they're quite a lot that look the same. This one is actually just a little Ipomoea, one of the smaller Ipomoea species. So, one of the small morning glory species. And a very firm favorite of lots of insects, bees, wasps, and the like. And, of course, the butterflies. Now I can see some Indigophoras growing here, but unfortunately they haven't flowered yet. And an Indigophora, there's actually probably I'm looking at, are these here, these little plants. They're very closely related to the pea family, and if you take out this whole plant with the roots and all, mash it up with a bit of warm water, it creates a beautiful indigo dye that's used traditionally. In New Zealand is wondering, are there any butterfly species we have that migrate? We do, Aaron. Probably the most common one is the brown-veined white, and they migrate seasonally around southern Africa. They're also one of the butterflies we'll see throughout the year, so not exclusive to the summer months. It's one of the few butterflies we'll also see in the winter months. Now, the one thing about wildflowers is some of them will only pop up every couple of years, and some will only pop up very shortly. So there will be certain species that will pop up now after the rain, and then not again for 5 years or 6 years. So that's the one thing that's always fascinating about flowers, and you always got to just keep checking, keep reading up on, because you never know when you're going to see one you might not see again for a very long time. We're going to keep moving in search of flowers, butterflies and birds. While we do that, let's go see what Madam Taylor is up to.
At the moment, we are trying to solve the mystery of the missing caterpillar, which we just had on this little shrub that you were looking at. It was the most magnificent little caterpillar. I probably the larvae of maybe one of the vagrants, and it's just disappeared. It was here a second ago, and I don't know if it magically pupated and it flew away or what happened to it. That was quite funny. But there's a couple of other things hopping around. We're going to try and find one for you. Now, there's a few milkweed locusts, some of the little ones that are hopping here, but I want to find this one in specific. I've seen the shrub move. Let's see. This is anything? No, I think we just stood on that. Now, this is the fun about everything being live, is that one minute you have something and you turn your back and then it's completely disappeared. That was the fastest moving caterpillar I've ever seen. Where's the locust? Everything has run away from us now. That's okay. There's Herbie, where's that yellow grass, that yellow locust gone now? Let's see if we can find it again, because that's what we're actually going to show you. And now it has hopped away, but that's okay. Maybe we can look at these ants. Come and see what these ants are carrying. They look hard at work. You can see there's a couple of them. Little red ants. They look a bit big to be safari ants. Safari ants are usually much smaller than those little guys. And it looks as though that ant is carrying the outer casing of a seed, perhaps from a grass. Probably going to take that back to its mound. I can't see where they're all coming from, because there's quite a few of them hard at work. And it's really amazing with ants how there's so many different types of feeding patterns that you get. Sometimes it looks quite erratic to the untrained eye. Even my eyes, sometimes it looks like they're just racing around, sort of doing all sorts of random things. But it's a technique that they use. But these guys don't seem to be too erratic. They look quite relaxed, and they look like they know exactly what they're going. Oh, this one's got a termite. Can you see that? That one over there. Let me move this out of the way. There we go. There we go. There's a couple of them. So they've obviously gone and raided a termite nest. Probably one of the harvester termites, maybe the slightly smaller harvesters. And now they're gonna take them back. So feeding on a variety of different types of vegetation. And I did also just see a little locust. Let me see if I can find it again. Oh, that's the problem with all these amazing creatures. And as we've seen with that praying mantis, how camouflaged everything is. And you look away for just a second and it completely disappears into the grass. And that's obviously how their camouflage works, though, is that when they freeze, the most basic technique to hide away, they disappear. But not the ants. They're pretty easy to spot, especially when they are carrying little foreign objects. You can spot them even when you're standing up. I wonder where their nest is. Because they might have a far way to go before they get to take their treats back home. And I'm sure that everybody will be quite happy as they are bringing back a meal. But that's okay, let's carry on. Let's maybe walk, and maybe as we shuffle through the ground, we'll see something that jumps and catches our eye and sort of releases that flash coloration, those brightly colored that they normally have underneath their wings. Let's see. Here it is, I found it. Okay, now, Matthew, I'm going to get to your question now. I've managed, you see this little shrub over here that's standing up? Yeah. There is milkweed locust sitting on it. It's running away from us. So if you maybe go, can you see it? It's just on the other side. Oh, there, it's just jumped. Let's see if we can get it to sit still. This is going to take some difficult work because it's quite a shy little milkweed locust. And I can't get too close to it. I'm going to stand on the other side, but look at that. Look at those different colors, the black, the yellow. This is what I was, one of the things I was trying to find you that disappeared. So I'm glad I've sort of redeemed myself again and we've managed to spot it. Now it's just a young one, and I suspect with all the rain that we've had and the abundance and the bloom of insects that have come through, we're gonna start to see a lot of these milkweed locusts, and they almost plague the areas. They can be a bit of a pest. But this is still a young one. And I'm sure you remember how big they get. Sometimes they get to almost the size of your hand, well, the length of your hand. And this is just a teeny tiny one you can see sitting on a blade of grass. I've even lost it now with my, oh, there it is, my naked eye. Now, automatically, like I said, with the yellow, bright yellow and the black on it, a bit of red when it opens up, when it leaps away, you would not want to eat this one. This would not be very tasty. Those are warning colors, episomatic coloration. Isn't this just incredible? We're having the most fantastic morning out here, finding all these incredible little critters. And I look forward, though, for the return of the adults, because you'll probably be able to pick one up and have a better look at it. These types of things I'm not afraid of. Just the spiders that I don't enjoy picking up, and of course the scorpions. Isn't that beautiful? Now it's amazing that it's so shy. Everything else we seem to have seen this morning, oh, there we go, now it's showing itself quite nicely. God, slowly it's moving. Is it eating? Oh, look at the beautiful legs, powerful legs, obviously used for jumping. Now I apologize, Kirsty, could I have Matthew's question again? Matthew, I haven't forgotten about you. Now, sorry, Matthew, you were wondering if the animals use the roads to walk on or do they create their own? It's a combination of the two. Obviously, we've put these massive big roads in and, well, something like an elephant or even something small like an impala or a millipede will, of course, use our roads. But if you missed it a little bit earlier, we were actually walking on some of the animal pathways. Now, I can't seem to find anything here, but we're going to go back around this way and see if there's anything down here. And if we do find another big prominent animal pathway, hopefully a hippo pathway, Matthew, because they are probably the easiest ones to see in the bush. But Herbert has found something. He's pointing. He's playing charades with me again. My favorite game. But let's go and see what's at the base of this little shrub. Herbert, we're on form today. We're finding all the small things. And that's what's so nice, is that it's not always about finding the bigger creatures. What is it, Herbert? Are you looking in here? We're gonna get Herbie. Oh, underneath. Whoa! The scorpion man. My goodness. We need a stick for this one. Let's see who is hiding under this log. Now I'm gonna see if I can push it out from this side. It's got a little burrow here. Out you go. Out you go. Out you go. There we go. Massive pincers. Get this little guy. No, 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 come back. We wanna see you. Go back out. Okay, maybe we can chase him this way. Come. One more little look at this scorpion. It looks like it's maybe one of the burrowing scorpions. Look at that. One last little look. We really are having an incredible morning here. Scorpions, two different types of scorpions. This looks like one of the burrowing scorpions, like I said. And there's quite a few different species of those. Right, little scorpion, we'll put your little house back on you and let you go back to rest and avoid the sun. And I think while we do this, very gently, let's go across and see what James is up to now.
Welcome back again. Unfortunately, the gremlins slash aliens prevail. What are you shouting at, Birdie? Oh, don't fly away, of course. So it seems like when the gremlins prevail, everything is going wrong. I think Homer's left the property, the wild dogs didn't come in. There's a very upset little bird. So we're gonna swing. Oh, he's gone. Groundscape with ashes. No, they're still there. Let's try and get a different view. Okay. Making lots of noise. I saw him land. Okay, let's go back again. Plenty of noise. Okay. Oh, no, man, you naughty birds. Flying away from me. Terrible creatures. We'll move along. There's some ground scraper thrushes. And yes, a very well done to Raisa, Gail, and many, many others. You were spot on with the little wader we had earlier. It was indeed a wood sandpiper. Now, I know, the one thing I'm really looking for now is a flowering indigofera plant. So we saw the indigofera without any flowers, and I'm just looking for one, because they are such interesting little plants. Now, I told you the obvious that it's a dye that's used in baskets, but it has an incredible amount of different uses. It's got a high antiseptic quality, so it's used as a, in a powdered form for burns, for cuts, for scorpion stings, bee stings, and it even has been shown to have some stopping capabilities with certain cancers. And even in India, it's used as a cure for arsenic poisoning. So a really versatile little wildflower. But it seems like Commander Bond is back with a mammal.
Well, we did have a mammal. Unfortunately, obviously today it's gone to hide behind some trees. It's another group of Nyala bulls, of which we've seen a number today. There they are. I'm sorry about missing out on our leopard tortoise, but luckily you had seen one already today. Oh, and I said to you Brent was going to give you sad news about the Nkuhumas. That sad news was that I thought they'd been found on Biffle's Hook, in other words, that we couldn't go and see them. It wasn't them, though, but it is actually quite happy news. It is a sighting we can't go to. It's Mvula, so that's very nice. He is, of course, one of our favorite leopard characters, an old fellow, and we hadn't heard of for some time, but he's back on Biffle's Hook, so that's good news for us. Let's go a little bit forward. I'm not sure if we're going to use the drone to look at these things. We are. Here we go, and up into the sky. And there we are, with drone. Now the Nyalas are off to the left-hand side of the vehicle. There we go. Well, apparently you can't see them. Well, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 Nyala bulls. 7 Nyala bulls in here. Connor, come over to the front of the car and we might get a better look at them. Let's see how they react. If they do react in a negative fashion, don't worry. I mean, they'll be absolutely perfectly capable of coming back to this area if they want to. Oh, there you go. You've got them in the distance there. Now, I'll just talk you through what they're doing. They're currently not reacting, really. One or two of them have looked up. Two, the others are sort of browsing away at the forbs that they can find to eat. And now you can see them nicely. It's a big bachelor group of Nyalas. It's not common to find them in such proliferation like this. I don't think that's the correct word to use. It's not often that you find them in such large groups. Let's try and not be so fancy about it. There we go. Now you've got a wonderful view of them. Yes, I see Connor went a little bit too far there. He went most of the way to Messina, but he's come back now. And there we are. Gorgeous. The light's coming out now. I'm sure you can see the difference in the colours as the light's popped out. As Connor does a little circling around us. Very nice. I'm going to keep moving forward slightly while DC Teagues does his little sort of wrap around. I'm really pleased to see that the Nyala hardly reacted at all to the drone. They didn't seem to be in the least bit affected by it, so that's good news. We want the animals to be completely unaffected by everything we do here. Same goes for Ronald the Rover, of course. And Connor's now coming with us. I think what we're going to do is a brief turn past Biffle's Hook Dam before making our way back for Saturday morning bacon and eggs, which of course should be eaten as often as possible. And I believe you have a beautiful shot of the eastern horizon with the clouds dissipating what is often a very harsh summer light, but not this morning. very pretty indeed. Do you think that adds a lot to our drive? I think it's just great, especially on a day when we're not sort of sitting with the pride of lions or our leopard friends that we know so well. It's a really nice way to just have some beautiful views. And I think, you know, I don't know how many of you have been watching that wonderful Planet Earth show or that Savage Kingdom show on that Geo, but half of what makes those shows so successful, I think, is just the sheer beauty of it. It's not necessarily the action, it's just the colors and the wilderness and the look at a world completely different from that most of us live in. And I think the drone gives us a little bit of that. Taylor, everybody, is with something that terrifies the wits out of most people here. Well, a piece of it anyway.
Now, this is one thing that I'm not too afraid of. I'm quite fond of snakes. I think that they are creatures that people don't quite understand and fear them. And, well, this skin of a snake that we're looking at, well, it's earned the right to be quite a fear. Now, the reason why I can tell that it looks like a black mamba, I'm going to have a look, and I apologize, my hands are very dirty now, is that if you look at its head, can you see it's got a very sort of coffin square-shaped head rather than like a triangular head like a puff adder would have? And I'm going to show you, is a stick. Let's see if this one will work. I'm going to open up its mouth. It's probably in its first, maybe just over its first year of its life. If I can open that, look at that. Inside its mouth there. How incredible is that? And this is a perfect skin. It's almost intact. Now, how a snake sheds its skin is what it does first, is that it will try and make a little tear somewhere in the nose, so it'll probably rub up against a rock or a stick and loosen the skin, and eventually it'll wiggle its way out. And I'm going to try and unwrap this because I think this would be perfect to take back for James and the tent, so we will try and unwrap it quickly and we'll have a better look and see how long it actually was too. But we've got to be gentle with it. I don't want to tear it. Now, a snake can shed its skin a number of times in the first year of its life. They reckon every couple of weeks or so they will shed its skin. So let's have a look how long this is. That's pretty long, don't you think? That's probably about three rulers, I would reckon. That's really incredible. That is just absolutely amazing. Right, oh, sorry, Brian. The wind took the tip of my tail. Let me finish your shot off. And there it is, in this amazing little skin. Like I said, absolutely perfect. Not really torn too much at all. Just completely split. No, it's not completely split. Sorry, I thought it had a tear in it, but it's not. Even this is completely solid. Look at that. Look at these amazing scales that they are covered in. Beautiful colouring. And probably quite a young mamba. It's not very big, not very thick just yet. But, well, try and keep it safe. I don't want to put it in my pocket, so I might just make a little necklace out of it for now. There we go. Fantastic, right? And this will keep it safe. And every time I go on a walk with Herbert, we probably travel maybe about a mile, maybe 2 miles at absolute most. I mean, even that I think is really pushing it. We just sort of do loops and kick over branches and trees and pop our heads into some shrubs and turn over a piece of bark. And it really is just an incredible world down on the ground. And I keep saying that today, but with the amount of things that we've been seeing, I really am so surprised. From termites to ants carrying termites to geckos to two different scorpions, millipedes creeping in, all little shots. But it's been a wonderful morning once again. And I love the bushwalk, so hopefully I'll be out on foot again. So from myself, from Brian, and of course from Herbert, the man who keeps us safe at all times, it's been absolutely wonderful. And we'll probably catch you again this afternoon on the